Come on, keep cantering.
It's 7:30 in the morning out on the gallops above Lambourne Village. The icy wind makes it bitterly cold. The fog restricts the view. But Jenny Pitman and her string of 27 horses are hard at work.
I could have fallen off there, then.
Jenny, a farmer's daughter from Leicestershire, hasn't missed a day's training since she started 6 years ago. She's been increasingly successful each year, but now she's preparing for the biggest challenge of her life. She has three horses entered in Saturday's National, and the bookmakers give one of them, Corbiere, a very good chance indeed.
If you don't know what you're doing, say so.
But win or lose on Saturday, racing experts predict that Jenny, at 35, is poised to go to the very top of her profession. A profession she really couldn't have avoided.
I was very lucky. My dad, who I think the world of, he had a small farm and he had his own horses. Always had horses, always had more horses than cattle, which is very unprofitable. He taught me to ride, and we used to have other people's difficult ponies, which my dad used to get going and I used to ride them.
Here is a rambling former pub in Upper Lambourne Jenny bought when it was derelict 6 years ago for £20,000. Soon other owners followed Stratton Smith's lead, and the business has mushroomed to the extent that the morning schedule now resembles a factory production line. And the trainer has to be both physically and mentally resilient.
It's tough. What's difficult about it is trying not to show your feelings. I mean, if I get a horse that's injured, I feel like crying. But I can't be seen to be in floods of tears on the racecourse because it's just not done, and people would think that I wouldn't be able to cope with my business. I don't cry. I do when I get home. 6:45, I get up in the morning, I make a cup of tea, and I go through a sporting life, which is the racing paper. In that racing paper, we will have the runners for tomorrow's meeting, and also the horses that have been declared for the next 4 days. I will look at my horses and see how well off they are in with other trainers' horses, and I will then decide whether my horse is likely to run in the race tomorrow or in 4 days' time. If I've got a horse that's very fast and I'm working it with a horse that's not so fast, I will put a heavier lad on the fast one and a lighter lad on the slower one to handicap them, to try and bring them together. We go out at 7:30, and then it will depend what sort of work he's going to do. He'll either do a real good gallop because it's day four, he'll have a canter on day four, do a real good gallop on day three, and have a blow on day two for the race on day four. We finish working the horses by about 8:30, 8:45, and we come back. I would have my breakfast then and do the declarations. I then decide, because I've seen the entries in the race, whether I wish to declare my horse. It's a bit like playing brag, having a look at the runners for the four-day stage. Then I either shoot off to the races or I do my entries or general paperwork. As you know, with the business, there's an awful lot of paperwork to be done.
Any around the front? Yeah, there is.
And the work doesn't stop even for meals. The chit-chat between owners, trainers and jockeys invariably centres on the upcoming events. This week, the National has been on everyone's lips.
All the top horses, there can be excuses for. Grittar's got dicky old legs. Spartan Missile's been off for a very long time. I mean, he did run well enough the other day, but he's been off for a long time. He's now an old horse. My horse is a young buck, and he's ready to go out and do battle. Ah, hello, Chris. Mandy's just left with the entries.
As soon as I walk through the door, the telephone starts ringing, and that won't stop until 10 o'clock at night. People don't usually ring after 10 o'clock because I go to bed at 10:30.
Yeah. Thanks, bye.
The Jockey Club has only issued licences to women trainers since 1966, yet the sport is still dominated by men. How much of that is sexism?
Quite a lot, in as much as there are events that fellas can go to, like the stable lads boxing. We're asked to enter lads for the boxing, and I've had two lads get to the finals, which are run at the Grosvenor Hotel. And it's an all-male do, and we're not allowed to go there, which is really annoying. And every year there's an argument because one of the female trainers, one of the lady trainers, has got a boxer in the finals, and they won't let us go and have dinner with the fellas. We have to go and sit on the balcony with the people that run it and the rest of the stable lads that are watching it. I've got nothing against sitting with the stable lads, but it does annoy me that they have women waitresses, they have women taking the things round that they're raffling during the evening, and for some reason or other they see fit not to allow us to watch our own lads boxing.
Isn't there a danger, though, that when the lads have a night out on the bevy, the owners and trainers, that Jenny Pitman misses out?
Yes, I know that poaching does go on, because my owners have said to me, oh, I was on the same table as so-and-so last night, and he said that he had a nice horse if I'd like to pop round for a drink and have a look at it, which is, you know, the usual form, pop round for a drink and we'll show you something that you might be interested in.
Did you find, though, or have you found at all in your career as a trainer, that there is sort of an unwritten rule that women can't actually do the job as well as men?
I think that in the beginning people used to think that, but I certainly don't think they think it now.
Come on, keep them going, go on.
We've got a lot of people that say well done, you know, if you've had a winner or a good winner. And I've got a lot of supporters, and I'm sure most of the other women trainers have. There's only a few when I first started, but there's a lot more now. And I like to be judged on what I've achieved and not by the fact that I'm a woman.
When you do succeed in this sport as a woman, people start putting labels to you, like hard, dedicated. It almost implies that you're not feminine.
I think if being professional about your job is being called tough, then yes, that's what I am. I like to be professional about my job. People say I don't suffer fools gladly, and I think that would be a fair assessment. As to not being feminine, I like all the things that other women like. I like jewellery, I like nice perfume, I like nice clothes. I can't afford them very often, but, you know, I like them if I have to have them. And I like flowers, I like, you know, everything else that any woman would like. I like to be treated like a woman as well. The horses, quite honestly, are not a lot different to young children. You get some that are very lovable, you get some that are very tough.
Well, it's a bit over. Come. Come on, boys. Come on, boys.
His feet have improved out of all recognition, haven't they?
They certainly have, Jenny. Is he still trying to overreach himself a bit, or is he glad of that habit?
Well, it was desperate about a year ago, but he's fortunate he's stopped doing it now.
Corbiere's a very tough horse. He's not a bad-mannered horse. We've got another horse here called Juiznich Hill. He can be a little bit unruly, and you can imagine him going out for the evening in a pair of Doc Martens boots and several studs in his ear. They're very much like that, you know, very, very much like people. If it was all brute force and ignorance... Sorry, I won't say that. If it was all brute force, the fellas would win every time.
Careful.
No, it's true. If it was just brute force, the fellas would win every time.
You've said that a woman has to achieve four times as much as a man to get the same kind of credit. And do you still believe that?
Yes, I do. I won the Welsh National, and in actual fact, the Welsh National, the first three horses trained in the Welsh National were trained by women. In one of the newspapers, The Horse and Hound, which writes about every event associated with the horses during the past weeks, it's a weekly magazine, it never had a mention of the Welsh National in it, not a photograph, nothing. And the Welsh National would be one of the biggest races in the National Hunt calendar.
He's named after...
Of Jenny's three runners in the National, it's Corbiere that carries the main stable hopes. The bookmakers certainly fancy his chances. They make him third favourite.
He's a super horse. He came from Ireland. I bought him as a two-year-old. I've always had him in mind for winning the National. Right.
It's always been a race that I've wanted to win. I was married to Richard Pitman, who was second in the Grand National on a horse called Crisp, only beaten a very short distance by Red Rum. And I was so upset after that if anybody ever mentioned the Grand National for 6 months afterwards to either Richard or myself, I couldn't bear to talk about it, and I just used to mosey away because I knew that I would have tears in my eyes just thinking about the race and the agony that I went through watching that horse run the last mile of that race and knowing that it was going to be beaten such a short distance. It's always been the race that I would like to win. It is the toughest race in the world for both horse and jockey, and on the owners as well. I mean, you watch that race, it takes about 9 minutes to run, and it seems like 9 days.
If you do win the Grand National, do you think all the barriers against you as a woman will be down?
No, I don't think that at all. I don't think men change that quickly, quite honestly. I think that possibly one or two will. It would be nice to be the first woman to do it, but I don't think it'll make any vast changes. I don't think all of a sudden they'll, when I retire, they'll ask me to become a member of the jockey club, which is what I'd like to do. But I think that'll be a very, very long way away.